So first of all, I would like to welcome you here and thank you for your time coming to my talk, which are always flagged as fascinating, provoking, mind-blowing. So I hope that you will find it as well very interesting. So tonight, I will, as I said, I will reveal some of the secret behind all my correct predictions, previous election, basically everything. But core of the talk will be actually about how big data can help businesses, and also how all these my media attention, my correct prediction, these talks can break the barrier which still exists in industry, which are hesitating to venture into big data analytics. There are samples, good samples, where industry identified the power of big data. And I must mention that one of the first project what I have with Professor Susan Beckeng from Griffith Institute of Tourism was funded by National Environment Science Program on Great Barrier Reef, where we use the social media as human sensors. They funded now already third projects. We had as well good experience with City of Gold Coast. Tourism Research Australia also approached me and Susan to apply for tender. They realized the power of social media and big data analytics, actually. And now, as you can see, when all polling companies got it wrong, when even bookies got it wrong, that's not very often happens, I think. I was so certain that I put my reputation on the line. Actually, about 2 months ago, I did some basic analysis, quick analysis, and I seen that simply Labour don't have a numbers, and I announced that on several occasions. However, I was asked to give exclusive interview for news.com.au before the election about my prediction. So I started to worry because all polling companies and bookies are saying Labour will win, but my calculations show different. So I collected additional data and I was crunching the numbers. My big data clusters over almost overheated, working 100% CPUs all the time. Any calculations show that actually 77 or 78 seats coalition will win, and I published that in my article with news.com. However, I requested that my prediction is not made public until Saturday midday. I didn't want to influence the election, obviously. So there is a few more things what I wanted to say, yeah. As you will see, there was a huge media attention following my prediction and that article. Sky News, my daughter saw me in Sweden. My friend Skyped me from Chicago. ABC, Sunrise, and so on. And who knows how many articles as well. And I think I gave at least 50 interviews. As you will see later, after about 30 hours talking, I couldn't even pronounce. I'm not very good in pronouncing anyway, but I couldn't pronounce certainty and everything, you will see. So I'm not sure how many of you actually watched. I will not bother you too much with videos, but I want to, this was with ABC Morning News across the Australia.
For the opinion pollsters, there is one person who has a broad smile on his face. We're not talking about the Prime Minister, but rather the academic who not only managed to forecast the government's win, he also predicted the right outcome in the Brexit vote and also that Donald Trump would beat Hillary Clinton.
How did he do this? Professor Bela Stantic is the director of Griffith University's Big Data and Smart Analytics Lab, and he analysed social media to establish his predictions. He joins us now from the Gold Coast. Professor, good morning and thanks so much for joining us.
Good morning.
Tell me about how you did it.
What can I say? Scott Morrison said that he always believed in miracles. However, for me, it was not miracle. It was just mathematical certainty that a coalition is ahead.
So it was mathematical certainty established how?
Basically, because as you said, I predict almost everything, and I was always asked at my talks to make prediction. So about month and a half before, I did some initial analysis of social media, and I have seen that coalition is ahead, and I announced that on many occasions. However, because I was asked to give the exclusive interview before the election about my prediction, so last week I collected about 2 million tweets from about 500,000 unique accounts in Australia. I used the algorithms that we developed here at Griffith University and did deep analysis, and I concluded, and I published that in my original article, that Labor is only ahead in Victoria and in South Australia, and that coalition will for sure have majority government.
Bela Stantic, I really would love to know how, if you can. I know you can't share your algorithms with us, but this is what strikes me as strange, is that we know that Twitter is not broadly representative of all of Australia. There are many Australians who are not on it, who don't engage in it. In fact, sometimes it's even described as a bit of a bubble. So how can a sample, even a big one, from that one social media group paint a picture of a federal election outcome?
So there is several ways. Obviously, over the time, I learned how to discard bulk tweeting, fake posts and everything. Yeah. But you would be surprised that all ages are represented on Twitter. And I'm not expert in that area, but people say that people are more honest telling friends about their opinion and telling indirectly rather than answering the polls. And that's probably the reason why I can identify more correctly opinion of people.
So in a sense, you're sort of listening in on conversations and chatter rather than asking people questions down the line a la a traditional poll.
Yeah, that's true. So the, looking what actually they are talking, so I collected as well key terms related to policies of different parties, and then looked into the by algorithms, looked what is the sentiment of individuals toward a certain key terms, and then did the clustering by the region, by the location, and simple mathematical algorithms came up that it's mathematical certainly that coalition will have again government.
Is this the future of polling in your view, given that the old fixed telephone line polling simply doesn't work anymore? Is this the direction that the so-called pollsters, if their model is to survive, they're going to have to go in?
I think so. The, obviously that this big data analytics and availability of this vast volume of publicly available data give opportunity to get deeper insight. And I'm not aware what methodology Posters Company are doing, but obviously there is a room, at least in the first instance, to have some hybrid system to use this big data analytics along the phone lines.
Do we call what you do polling or mathematical prediction or social analysis?
Probably everything together.
A bit of everything, and I guess it's as you say that. Go on.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, probably everything together. Big data analytics. Probably best word to say.
And then certainly the way of the future. Before I leave you, have you got another prediction on anything else that you can leave us with this morning, Professor?
I'm not sure. On my Twitter account, I received a lot of questions. I was not even aware there is an election in Europe, there is an election in India.
However, last week I was really busy, concentrated. I put my reputation on the line, so I did very deep analysis of this one before I came out publicly. Mm. I gave interview on Thursday, but I requested that interview is not released until Saturday midday. I didn't want to influence election.
Well, that's very sound of you. That's a very good thing to do. So I'm glad you won't go early with a prediction now, but we'll definitely come back to you when the big events come up. Congratulations, and we'll stay in touch. Thanks, Professor.
Thank you.
Professor Bela Stantic.
So that, based on that one, always at my talks, I know one question is who will win this election, next election. So I did some homework. I have ready answers if you ask me. So there's one more video from Channel 7 I want to show you, because it's actually inside the Big Data and Visualization Lab, which we built at the Gold Coast, and it was opened in November by Mayor Tom Tate. So.
And Alex Lewis, a local data analyst, was one of the few experts who correctly picked the election results.
Yes, Amanda, the same man who predicted Brexit and that Donald Trump would win the US presidency. Well, while the coalition had been trailing Labor for a long time, the Griffith University professor claims he knew Scott Morrison would win months ago.
His name is Bela Stantic. He's the director of Griffith University's Big Data and Smart Analytics Lab. But the prophetic professor will accept another title.
If you want, Nostradamus or 21st century.
He defied the polls to predict Britain's Brexit vote and Donald Trump's presidency.
Previous federal election, Queensland election as well.
His soothsaying secret, science.
Basically by analyzing social media data.
Last week, Professor Stantic analyzed 2 million tweets
related to the key terms and hashtags,
using algorithms to calculate sentiment among voters. It confirmed what he claims to have seen coming a month and a half ago, a Scott Morrison win. Unlike more than 50 consecutive news polls, the professor blames small samples for their failure.
Oh, there is less and less the landlines, so it's very hard to identify where from people are coming.
He knows he's harnessed a potent political weapon.
I was approached with many overseas governments even to help.
But as a man of science, he wasn't interested. Alex Lewis, 7 Gold Coast News.
Okay, so now when media is over, let's go to the secrets, right? So it's obvious, right? Mathematical certainty. So the point is, there is so much calculations, actually, algorithms which learned over the time, identifying the targets, and over the time, they are learning on actually data, similar as human brain is reasoning. Most of these algorithms, core of the algorithms, we haven't published, and actually I haven't published, because on this part I worked all along. I did not involve on this specific election things anyone from my big data lab, because I just wanted to take the blame myself if something goes wrong, if I'm not correct, and not to damage their reputation. But to demonstrate you how accurate are these algorithms, obviously it's accurate because I think I got all seats correct, 77 or 78, I even don't know. Last time when you checked, everything was correct. So, for example, so this is the pure tweets. These are the sentiment in tweets. Let's concentrate to this one. So this is, in response to an extinction crisis, we have a prime minister who doesn't care, with the environment minister who can't be something. So it came back with -77, which is very negative, on scale of -1 to +1. So these sentiment analyses are nothing new. That's widely researched area. And we also in Big Data Lab, along the event projects, what we had with the Great Barrier Reef on tourism as well. There's different methods based on lexicon, dedicated lexicon, supervised machine learning. We did annotation of tweets, our students, and currently we are also doing some annotations as well. So that is something which is quite accurate. considering that even when three people or five people annotate, they have a different weight. But what is more important? So obviously, Twitter and social media are short messages. If you need to find what is the topic of the article, it's very easy, right? But Twitters are usually very short. A lot of abbreviation, mixed spelling, slang, and so on. So the, first you need to clean up the data to do the tokenization or lemmatizations to have a, at least restrict and also correct the spelling and everything. So then are algorithms actually which learn over the time. And for example, these tweets with 0.90999 target is Scott Morrison. Why only 0.01 is a Bill Shorten? So that, this is relatively probably not that hard, but there is a lot of which are very challenging to identify. Yeah. So that, that is only first step, right, to identify. Then all tweets have basically location where you open account. Most of them have as well where from people posted. And then also works with the preferences for the certain location. But that's why it's further down it's pure mathematics. And I said in my interviews, I don't find any more challenge to predict elections. I think it's straightforward. Last Queensland election, I predicted also correctly, and it's happened to be when was the Gold Coast Business Award night, and around 6 o'clock, Mayor and others asked me, if they know I predict, and I said, yeah, there will not be change of government, but it will be close, but it will not be decided 2 weeks. At 10 o'clock, Mayor came to my table and said, you were right, and I already had a few drinks. What can I do on gala dinner, right? So I said, I don't know why they are wasting money on this election. They they should just ask me who will win. So there's really possible with very high accuracy to predict these things, pending that you have a huge amount of data as well, and we have. So this is interesting. So that even my calculation and these overheating clusters, it probably was not required. All was required to put these 2 million tweets, what I collected a week before the election, and create the concept map with the software which is created with Leximax. And everything is clear. So this is a Bill Shorten. And Labour. This is a Liberal. This is what people talk about election, and this is what response they asked. So you can see that there is no overlapping between Labour and election, neither with what people, very small what they are asking. They're more talking about media, Murdoch, campaign, and so on. I was told today that this lady is actually in some newspaper as well. She posted that much that she came on board. Important aspect of election was as well gender agenda, gender equality, and you can see that it's significant bubble. Climate change, it's here, but it's more associated, surprising, with coalition rather than. So that. Point is that there is a different tools we can, which can extract the information and provide. But what is more important, these algorithms and elections are just test beds for algorithm what I and we develop at Griffith University. It is applicable to any business. So as I said, core of my talk is actually to convince you to venture into big data analytics because I'm Nostradamus, people say, and I know that any company or institution, if it doesn't venture into this big data analytics, probably will not be competitive and it will struggle to survive. So this is one quote part of the email, I received thousands of emails after election, and Megan is doing miracles to set me 10-15 minutes interviews and teleconferences. So I apologize if I did not reply or didn't have chance yet to talk, but I will reply to everyone and have a chat to see. So one of the emails from Carlo Bellini, some investor, he said, why not to believe people but rather analyze their behavior? I think that's exactly what I'm doing. I'm not listening just what they are saying, but what they are doing. And have a look. I immediately here have 171 people who I know how they will vote because they like the tweets, which is this person who was originally probably, he is not fan of Adani, but now his concern is because you can't just simply close 100 jobs. That was one of the big topics in social media. Actually, that idea to close the Adani and mines in regional Queensland, people didn't like that people from Sydney and Melbourne came in white-collar shirts to preach in a regional Queensland that they should close their job. Doesn't matter, they will not have job, but that's good for climate change. That message obviously can't be perceived very well. So even this person, I don't know who it is, he says he's not fan, but he's not supporting that actions. And 171 people. So that is exactly, you analyze behavior. So the secret of the big data analytics is not just diversity and volume of data, and it's also hidden information within that data. In this case, obviously, even through dislikes, not to mention comments and as well. So before I venture and start talking about projects and everything, how big data analytics can help businesses, because I believe that not all of you are in big data area. So usually big data is characterized with four main V's. In my journal article 4 or 5 years ago, I mentioned even six on top of that as value as well. It's basically one of the important aspects, it's a volume, that we have a huge amount of data. There's so many data now available, and it's really in a huge volumes. Velocity. Data comes very quickly. I will show you some later. I collected 800,000 tweets in one day in relation to Brexit. I mean, 500 million tweets per day is generated, or 4.5 billion likes on Facebook and so on. Do you remember every single piece is valuable information, even likes? Biggest concern at the moment, I think it's veracity. How reliable are data? I'm not sure do you know, but even for this federal election, there was a fake poll news that Labour will introduce a debt tax, and that was amplified in the social media. So it's very important to actually to trust the data, to source, and that is reason why I'm now working more on a lie detector for social media. So I think that is very important. I will show you later as well why. There is so many different formats of data, and I will show you as well later on next slide. But obviously there is structured from databases, unstructured, semi-structured data, text, obviously. We in our projects, we are harnessing as well Chinese social media, because Great Barrier Reef, 80% of tourists are from China, so they don't use Western media, but still these marine park authorities and NASP like to know what people like, where they go, and what opinion they have. So also emotions and so on. Obviously, that amount of the value of the information explodes if we take into consideration more data at the same time. Probably you cannot read this carton, but it says basically, your recent Amazon purchase tweets cool, and location history makes you 23.5% welcome here. I want to emphasize that 0.5, because that is the accuracy what you can obtain by analyzing this data. And I think I proved that in my work. So the just additional, it's basically in my work, I relied on the traditional systems. I have access to the student system, to QTech data, to predict what is the likelihood on enrollment of students to certain program, to certain university, and based on their OP subject, first in family, suburb, interest rate, real estate market, who knows what else. Also, data warehousing system where data is already processed. Obviously, social networking when we rely on, mostly on Twitter. Flickr for images. I will show you some interesting work, what we are currently doing together with Griffith Institute of Tourism. Also, we crawl a lot of pages. Queensland is one of the best with regard to amount to open data in Australia. So we rely a lot of open data, particularly on the weather data, health data, and so on. There a lot of blocks are really valuable as well, and so on. Even genomics, because I had a project as well on obesity and depression study. So issue with having the big data and process this diverse and huge volume of data is scalability. Obviously, you cannot every time buy more and more powerful computers, but it's easier to horizontal scale, most often in shared knotting architecture. And in my big data lab, I will show you some photos. And initially, when I started at university and in school, every 3 years we need to buy new computers for our labs for students. So rather than discarding them, we hooked them into the cluster, and that was how initially I started work in my big data lab until we got additional resources thanks to Pro Vice Chancellor and Griffith University as well. So, obviously, if you have $1 billion, you can afford to have a Cray, but if you don't, then you probably need to build some kind of clusters. First computer who break the 100 petaflops, and petaflops means this many mathematical operation per second. Can you imagine? And at the moment, it's fifth when I looked. Maybe it's now already sixth. It goes fast. So IBM, it's actually, Summit is at the moment the fastest with 2 million something cores and 200 petaflops. So that looks impressive, but we are not bad either at Griffith University. We have a quite computing infrastructure as well. And also, just for deep learning, recently we added GPUs altogether with 12,000 something cores. So, as Professor Smith mentioned, we introduced the first big data course. And then.
Every day, masses of data are being generated from shopping transactions, social media posts, GPS, medical monitoring devices, office documentation. And the list goes on. Companies, organizations, and governments are drawing connections between these massive amounts of data from a huge range of sources. This process is known as big data analytics.
Hi, I'm Sebastian from Griffith University. Analyzing big data helps to predict future trends, discover hidden patterns, and find out about customer opinions. From business to education to government and health services, many organizations can benefit from using big data analytics.
In this course, you'll gain insight into how big data analytics is employed in different industries to solve new problems that impact your daily life.
Griffith University's School of Information and Communication Technology
is home to the Big Data and Smart Analytics Lab. The lab specialises in the areas of big data management, machine and deep learning, and data visualisation. Our educators are recognised as world industry leaders who have published extensively in these areas.
Join us as we explore together the opportunities and challenges of big data analytics and what this means for your future.
So as Professor Smith said, we developed the first course, Big Data and Social Media. It was intentioned to attract students all around Griffith, mostly from business, obviously, marketing. But it turned that in the first intake, we had as many as academics and lecturers from other schools than students. I think now we have about 80. And the idea was then the introduction to this course, we compiled and we created, with my young researchers, we created massive online open course, which is free. It's 2 weeks. It's actually giving you a giving you information what is big data about, and also give you, if you want, you can continue to whole course where you will have chance to learn even to practically. Students actually access social media from their accounts and do all this analysis, even including this concept mapping what I showed you and other things as well. So this course is also a co-course for Bachelor Intelligent Digital Technologies, but it is also part of the double degrees in data science, along to another course, Introduction to Big Data Analytics. So, how? I already said a few hints, but obviously there is many things, including data mining, statistical modeling, natural language processing, machine and deep learning as well. Many of these algorithms are not published, and some of them, I believe, are groundbreaking. I couldn't find anything even similar in the literature. So, over the time, a system actually learns, and in some sense, it's a supervised learning, right? Because it learns and it uses that learned data back as an annotation. So, more data, more time ensures the high accuracy. So, for example, obviously that depending on age, gender, education level, background as well, you have a specific vocabulary. So it can learn and create the predictive model. So, for example, if I would not say cool stuff, right? Probably some young person said that one. So whatever you say one sentence, for example, this unknown person, let me tell you about what I do for a living. And my algorithm say, well, you are 27-year-old male, university or educated with medium salary. And I can tell you it's about 90% accuracy. So this is a simplified architecture that we have. So obviously you have a data layer, you have analytics and visualization. As I said, there is all sorts of data. We don't rely anymore on Facebook data. We tried several years ago, obviously only public Facebook pages. We don't have access to private. And we realized that a lot of this, it looks like public Facebook pages can be edited by owner and any negative comments can be removed. So it's not valuable and real. But we rely a part of Twitter. We rely on Flickr for images. We also look for Instagram. And additionally, as I said, we rely also on Chinese social media, Weibo, because of Chinese tourists on Great Barrier Reef. A lot of open data, including weather, health. I had access as well when we had project of QTech data. I was granted access to university data as well to correlate the enrollment, passing and everything with the progression, depending if it's your first preference, how it's likely you will graduate and so on. And a lot of crawling to extract the information. So the, a part of this old algorithm that we are developing, some of them we are publishing as well. Obviously, we rely as well on this interactive analytics and Storm, Spark, proven systems which can help to process a huge volume of data. Visualization layer, it's also state of the art, I would say, with Node.js, Ajax, D3, HTML5, and so, which ensures that you have a dynamic pages. I'll show you this as well because it shows.
We are in a big data and visualization lab, which is the state-of-the-art embedded reality facility for real-time visualization of big data. It is used for many real-time projects in diverse areas, including tourism, environment, business, and health. We intend to use it mostly for research. However, because of state-of-the-art nature of this facility, we intend to use it for delivery of advanced courses for new Bachelor of Intelligent Digital Technologies degree, and also enhanced delivery of courses in data science, including the double degrees with environment science engineering as well. Today we have so many data available, but basically maybe just 5% of data has been analyzed. But even this 5% of data which is analyzed have issues to be visualized, so need for this kind of facilities are required, where you can visualize and extract the information actually about the big data. So in the background of this embedded reality screens, it's actually high power computing as well, which in real time can process that huge amount of diverse data.
So that this is a big data visualization lab, which was opened, as I said, last year, and we will use it as well for teaching our advanced courses in data science, but also be virtual intelligent digital technologies on top of all these projects and marketing. Well, so as I said, I will mention that areas, there is, I even couldn't list everything. We worked a lot in tourism sentiment about specific target aspect, restaurant, what they're commenting, is it related to food quality or hotel value for money or whatever. And you can have that over the time and space in a real time. And that was also a project which was fully funded by City of Gold Coast. We wanted to go with some advanced Queensland or something, but when we provided them 2-pager what we want to develop, they say, oh, we don't want to wait that long. We will fund completely the projects. So that was the visitor information platform as well, where in real time you can see actually situation, what people are talking, where from, what is their sentiment over different things and so on. I was involved as well with transportation and relieving peak congestion. This is a current project that we are running together with Professor Susan Becken and Professor Rod Connolly from Environment, expert on marine science, where we are measuring aesthetic value, experience value using big data approaches. So basically we are analyzing underwater images, identifying what species of fish are. That's not much for you and for me either, but Professor Rod Connolly knows that certain species eat certain algae, and certain algae means a certain state of the reef. So indirectly, actually, you can create the heat map of what is the state of the reef. And we are in process. We have access as well to the scientific data from Eye on the Reef, and what is the next one? Coral Watch. So we correlate that data with our prediction as well, and we published some results in ASTAR Journal, Journal of Environmental Monitoring. I got access to the hospital emergency department and the university hospital, and looking to correlate the social media data with food poisoning, because always people, if they have any issues with food or restaurant, they mention that in social media. So probably inspector will follow the lead from the social media where to go to inspect. This is a very big project involvement of Professor Brendan Mackay as well, Professor Yoshi Zhou as well. And we look, is it outbreak of infectious diseases, how it's influenced with the climate change. It's actually a big project which will be funded by European Union. They are worrying that these infectious diseases will migrate to Europe if climate change. At the moment, we are doing the pilot here in Queensland. I'm accessing and collecting anyway with the data for Queensland. We are collecting now data, weekly data from the health, as well as the open data, and we will do the correlation. Travel pattern prediction on number of people in certain area, that's project what we are running as well, even using Chinese social media to see how it's actually people moving from one place to another, depending on their order and trajectory. And we will plan as well to look how actually sentiment on that certain location influence their trajectory. So, I did the projects where, even for the Commonwealth, because that is kind of crisis situation when you have a huge amount of people moving at once. And I did some prediction as well on the disaster management for cyclone, also to see what is the, predict the movement of people, but also to see what is their sentiment and also what is their need as well. Social media is more often faster than even 000. So people most often take and send in social media. And that was also idea, but it didn't go through for Commonwealth Games to build the red flag actually in the social media to indicate if something happened on certain location. It is possible to identify, obviously, common interest based on space-time. We have a very strong research on graph theory in our school, and we are looking into that as well. But that in some sense as well, where you are clustering it as well, election prediction. I had with Associate Professor Catherine Prentice, we submitted application for responsible gambling with Office of Responsible Gambling, but unfortunately our application was rejected. They did not accept it. That was before this media attention. But I mentioned that because now probably they are sorry for that. And they could get a project for small money. Now it's increased, obviously. Why I'm saying, because that is reluctance of industry to fund these projects ahead of time. There is no perception of people about these projects are not. Also, I can say that there is a damaging influence. A lot of people claim by analyzing few hundred images or some spreadsheets, then they are talking around, we are doing big data analytics. And obviously, outcome of these, it's not sufficient. And then other people who don't have a clear vision actually lose the confidence. So I, as I said, I hope with my reputation, with my talks, media attention, that I can break that barrier with industry and give confidence that real big data analytics can take your business to another level. And as I said, I'm happy to collaborate. This is something where we have one of the researchers in my big data lab who is very good and is looking into fake news. I particularly like to extend it and build it, as I said, lie detector. And there's many more particular now. I received at least 1,000 emails with the offer to collaborate. Some of them are more related to election, but many, most of them are related to the real event from meat industry and other so the areas. So that this is a, they say one picture says 1,000 words, right? So this says everything. This is actually data of social media before April 2016. I have chosen this one because in 2016, April, came actually publicly that there is a bleaching of Great Barrier Reef. But you see, it's quite evident that people talked about that in social media. Bleaching, barrier, worst, suffering, whopping, northern change, and so on. So that it's just with the right way to analyze and present data, it can provide you indirectly information which is stored inside. This is a project, what I mentioned, what we rely on Flickr, and one of the researchers who is working with us is here. Actually, you see here, you can not even recognize it fish, but it's managed to recognize even what type of fish. So that this was done, obviously, by deep learning using convolutional neural network. We published these findings as well. This is a team what
we would like to introduce a new research project today. It's about the aesthetic value of the Great Barrier Reef. And of course, we know the Great Barrier Reef is a UNESCO World Heritage Site and it's of outstanding beauty. But the question is, what do people think is beautiful? What do people like and how do you measure it? So that's part of this new project. And Professor Noel-Scott here will explain what we're doing, how we use new technology to determine the beauty.
Thank you. So what we're doing is we're using eye tracking technology to track where people's eyes are looking on at a photograph, and that tells us what they're interested in and what they find beautiful. And we can then analyze that to produce a heat map and also ask people what they like, so we can relate where people are looking to what they find beautiful.
And there are a couple of reasons we like to measure that. And one is that, in fact, aesthetics was part of the original listing of the World Heritage Area, so it should be monitored in its own right. But the other thing is that we think there's a link between the aesthetics and the health of the reef itself, the reef and the fish. And we want to get hold of that. We want to know what that relationship is.
So eventually, this heat map from eye tracking, we will use the deep learning and convolutional neural network to identify and create the function. So theoretically, on a huge amount of video and images, we will be able in real time to identify what the aesthetic value of any image or video.
So using data sources, for example, for Instagram would provide those large volumes of images, whether it's photos or videos, that we could then process using artificial intelligence to determine the beauty of the reef, but maybe also the ecological changes. So we're quite excited about this project. We thank the Australian government for the National Environment Science Program for funding it, and we hope that this approach of citizen science gets people involved in research on the Great Barrier Reef.
So that basically eye tracking, and we ask people to say how it's aesthetic, and then we rely on machine learning as well to, and deep learning on unseen video or image. We can assign what is aesthetic value. A part of underwater depends what we trained with the underwater images, but Randru is training with other things as well. So even if you give me any poster or any photo, system can tell you what is the aesthetic value and how will people perceive your poster or anything. So that we also published this one. There is a lot of other information what indirectly is hidden in this data. For example, how many people are visiting depending on month, where from they are coming, depending on where from they are coming, what is their interest, what they like to see, because obviously different background and different cultures have a different interest. and also differently perceived. It can give you indication of number of visitors as well, because we have algorithms who can distinguish between locals and visitors as well. This is a visitor information platform funded by City of Gold Coast. So it's not just tell you where from are people posting, but also what they are talking, how is that related, and what is the sentiment in real time. This is related to the project Fake Reviews. You know that you can review on the TripAdvisor, Google, and Zomato, and a few others. But there is so many fake reviews. You will be surprised how many that one person gives hundreds of reviews, bad reviews in one day. So we are finding ways as well to identify, not just, that's obvious, right? Which are actually fake reviews. Also, where from are people coming? If they are visiting Great Barrier Reef, how many? That's important as well. That is a funded project, Great Barrier Reef Marine Fund Authority, I think. And so to give the indication where they should market, what people have interest to see. This is interesting. We crawl the data from the seek.com, where is the jobs, and you can see, depending on what area, what type of job, where, we can see as well what is the key skills based by analyzing text in the description of the job. You can see the salary range, differences between different states, different towns, salary for the same job, same skills, and so on. So that could be good indicator as well for the educators as well, to align their programs to upskill certain people in certain areas as well. This is something what is driven by Dr. Henry Nguyen. And I would say this is also ahead of time. You know that Google has, not Google, now everyone has. You travel from A to B 25 minutes, for example, it tells you. It gives you maybe option, two different routes, 3 minutes faster or slower, but does not take into consideration environment where you will drive. This Happy Maps, it's basically we downloaded street view of all streets and used the deep learning to recognize how much is the nature, how much is heavy traffic, and other things. So you have option to drive 25 minutes through heavy traffic, construction, concrete, or you have an option to drive 32 minutes through green alley. So I will probably choose 32 minutes, right? Because anyway, you will get stuck in that heavy traffic. It will be 32. So this is something what we are working now, and I would say as well it's ahead of time. So important aspect, as I said, it's rumor and lies as well. So for example, specific what we cited in paper, what we recently published, is to have a rumor, you must have something what is breaking news. You must have a credibility of source, and you must have a reason why you're sending that. In this case, it was tweeted from one of the major newspapers from hacked Twitter account that there was an explosion in the White House and even injuring Barack Obama. And that in a matter of minutes, wiped out 136 billion from the share market. It's not much of a surprise, because if this is major newspaper, maybe had 100,000 followers, if they retweeted, everyone has 100,000. So basically, this breaking news can reach audience of hundreds of million people in a matter of minutes. And that's why it's very important that you have in place system who can actually identify and block this system. It's not simple, but Otherwise, I believe these all social media we are already implementing. So I'm pretty much on time, I believe so. So in conclusion, obviously, that this big data analytics will be driven by the request for the complex, more and more complex analysis, which is able to predict the future and to correlate that future dynamically with the change. That is the reason as well why I didn't want to come out with my prediction for federal election before it was already election, because I could influence election. I think that last time, only thing that I got wrong is the same-sex marriage. But I came out, I think, 10 days before. At that time, it was very close, leaning toward no. And when it was picked up by media, it was almost as big media attention like this time. And I don't have time, but if I have time, I will probably do some analysis to see. Because since media attention, before that, it was maybe a few thousand every day voting. Since I came, media attention about that it will be no, 1.5 million people voted. I believe if they voted, most likely yes. So which means that if I didn't come with my prediction, probably it will be no. I'm not certain, but if I have time and access to data, I will do analysis. So that's why it's very important that it's not, because all this can be self-influenced as well. So also this big data analytics will be more and more easier to do it, because it will be more and more data, Internet of Things will be available in more as well. So the challenge will be to extract in a real time. And for that reason, all these systems, what we currently have traditional for accessing, storing, management, analysis, simply doesn't work on this big data, and completely new frameworks are required. Some of them we haven't published yet, right? In order, so new frameworks are required, and my big data and smart analytics lab and I are working on it. But I'm also looking forward working with you, as I said, to break area of resistance and enable of new big data analytics era. Thank you for your attention.